Hariom, everybody, namaste. I welcome all with the, for the discussion with the Pranav and Kaustubh. So Pranav, to give a background of Pranav, he comes from, he studied in IIT Madras and he is pursuing his PhD in science in the top university, Princeton. And Kaustubh is an engineering student studying in NIT Suratkal. So now, Kaustubh has some questions. Because both people, one person comes from science background, another person from engineering background, I'll try to answer the questions in the that background. So Kaustubh, you can start with your first question.
Yeah, a couple of days ago, I had an interesting question about reincarnation.
Yes, please.
Yeah, a couple of days ago, I had a question about reincarnation, whether reincarnation is it actually possible? Like, is reincarnation really happening? Like, I want a rough idea about what reincarnation is.
Okay, now I'll not go into spirituality or Vedanta background. First, let me start with the science background. Okay, because you people come from the science background, right? So there is a law of conservation of mass and law of conservation of energy in science, if I'm correct, right?
Yeah.
It means matter cannot be destroyed or energy cannot be destroyed.
Yeah.
Okay. Total amount of matter and energy in the universe remains same. This is what my understanding is.
Yes.
Now what happens to the matter and energy? It keeps on taking different forms. Right? Energy appears as atoms and molecules. Atoms are subatomic particles. Subatomic particles appear as atoms and molecules. Atoms and molecules organize as grosser matter. Like that, there's a change of form, but there's no essence doesn't change. The energy and matter cannot be destroyed. Is that correct? Am I correct?
Yeah.
So that's called law of conservation of matter or energy. Correct? So now, let us take one step forward. There are two types of matter. One is dead matter, inert, and living matter like plants, animals, and all. So typically the reincarnation question is asked about the living beings like humans and all, right? But let me first take to the plant level. So a plant grows, a seed is there, it grows and it becomes a tree. And one day the tree dies. So what will happen to the matter and energy in tree?
It still remains. Or it gets transferred.
It starts becoming a fertilizer. The tree starts rotting.
Yeah.
It will become a fertilizer.
Yeah.
Correct? So now that fertilizer, the tree rotting tea, all bacteria and amoebas will eat that. Or it becomes a fertilizer for other trees to grow. So the tree itself has changed the form, but the substance, which is energy and matter, has not changed. Do you agree? Now, this change, I call it as reincarnation of tree. Just by definition.
Okay, so the tree is reincarnated into a fertilizer.
The tree has become fertilizer. Fertilizer has become other trees. And it has become other bacteria. Okay, so I'm just saying, just giving a definition, my own definition. The tree is reincarnated as a bacteria or another tree or multiple trees. This is the tree level, correct? So now this is a living being. Tree is a living being, correct? So let us take the matter level, matter. In the matter, there is a energy at the basic level. The energy appears as subatomic particles. Subatomic particles combine together, become atoms. Subatomic particles become atoms and atoms become molecules. So at the subatomic particle level, there is a reincarnation in terms of change of form at the energy level or matter level. So the matter keeps on changing the form. That I call as a reincarnation. Okay, now let's go to slightly higher level animals. So the plants you leave, then you go to animals. Okay, at animal level, we see there is, in addition of life, there is information, there's knowledge. For example, human being, as a human being, you have a knowledge, right? Plants also may have knowledge. Stones have may have also knowledge. We don't know about it, but it may be there, right? So the knowledge, as a body, as human beings, as a body, when we die, the body becomes a fertilizer, and it will go into become a tree, or it get into river, it gets into some other life form. So it will grow. It will become, it takes the form at the body level, physical level. Right? But what will happen at the psychological level, information content in us, will the information content also be going from one body to other body? That is the question. Right? So that ultimately when you say reincarnation, it's actually information content going from one body to other body, finally.
Yeah.
Correct? Not even the physical level. Physical level, anyway, it's we know it's changing structure.
Yeah.
I met a very interesting boy. I was conducting a class in Pune. So the mother brought a boy who is 2 year old. So the mother told me about the story about the boy. So boy has started just talking, started talking. Okay, now when the mother and the boy were walking in the, we are going in the, what we call as streets of Pune, when the young boy, he had just learned how to speak. Then on the street of Pune, when the main road, he told the mother, stop here. Okay. Stop here. The mother stopped. He said, this is the place where I died. Okay. He said, okay, that's a young boy. He has just learned how to speak. Death and birth, he doesn't know. So he says, I died here. A lorry, I was riding a cycle and I died in a lorry accident, he said. The mother was shocked actually. A boy, young boy of 1.5 years speaking about death. She started avoiding going in that street. Every time she goes in the street, he says, I died here. So then what she did, she avoided the street and started going through residential area. And the boy is 2.5 years old. He says, stop here. See, that's my house. My wife is there. Let's talk to my wife. Okay. This lady got scared. She avoided the house and she went to that lady's house, and asked that lady. So that lady said, 7 years back, her husband died. He was riding a cycle and he died when he fell below, when he went to the lorry accident in the same spot where the boy was saying. So this is a case of random, it's not a proof, but this is what I actually came across a boy who told about that. A young boy of 2 years, 2.5 years can't remember what, doesn't know about birth and reincarnation. So then what happened? That's one thing. Then in the medical history, scientific history, there are a lot of psychiatrists who have studied about reincarnation. Okay, past life. So they do something called past life regression, hypnosis. So you are able to recollect past life memories and they go to that place to find out whether the memory is correct or not. Of course, we cannot do this tracing for many, many lifetimes. We can do some to some extent. And there are recorded histories in many psychiatrists about the past life and the actual nature of the past life. When the person says about through hypnosis, they go there and find out. There is a scientist in the, I have heard that there is a lady scientist in the NIMHANS who has done extensive research on past life. She has gone and found out the places. So like that, there are recorded medical, in medical history, mainly psychiatrists have traced the past life regression. Past life through hypnosis, but that cannot take very, very long time. But some, there are at least to prove that that at least the indicator that there's something called past life. Okay. And past life memories are carried forward. So then second, this thing is there are some prodigies, child prodigies. Okay. So the child prodigies like there are many, many young children who are very brilliant. Very brilliant. They achieve very excellence in science, technology, mathematics, very engaged. So if you look at their life, they don't get their background from the surroundings. Somebody becomes a music prodigy. Now, how did they become music prodigy? The feeling is they carried forward the information from their past life. So then there is another research. You can pick up these in the internet or study journals. When there are twins. Okay, twins are born at the same time, maybe with a few minutes of difference. So the scientists have studied the twins who are born but got separated because of some reason, because of an accident, because of some reason, they got separated out and they started living in different places. And these twins meet after 30 years or 40 years of life. Till that time, they don't have any contact with each other, no information exchange. So now, many things what scientists found out, that these people, even though they are living separately for 30 to 40 years, they have identical habit patterns, including their own name, including the name of their wife, including the name of children, including the hobby. They have identically. They have shared some information without really coming together. Where did information happen? The information must have come at the time of birth. Okay. So then there is another research by a Dr. Sheldrake. I think you might have heard of him, Dr. Sheldrake. What he has said, what he has found is that there is an information field all over the world. If one animal learns something at one place, okay, the other animals in the same place some also learn, not because physical contact. They are learning able to, there is information exchange happens, there's through information field. For example, he tried one rat, mouse. The mouse tried to solve a puzzle of maize, that what they call maize. They hide some food in the maize. The mouse, one rat solves the maize. Then another rat, which is unconnected somewhere else, is also able to learn it. So there's a collective learning happening through human species or animal species also in the information field. So I'll tell that in that way. There is an energy field, which is translates in matter. There's an information field, which is also responsible for organizing this energy. Okay, please understand, these are all, I'm not saying it's science. This is my understanding. I can't claim it as authentic science. So the energy field and information field try to organize the matter into more and more complex things. So this is neither the energy nor the information gets destroyed. So they only change the form. So this changing of the form is what I call as reincarnation. Yeah, those who are not speaking, can you please mute? Yeah, when you are listening, just mute. Okay. Yeah. Is there does that answer question answer your answer? Does this answer your question at the first level, basic level?
Yeah.
So there's one more thing to this. So I told about past life regression. Okay. I just mute it when you listen. Okay. When I studied one of the past life regression done by a psychiatrist in New York, he published it in one of the books. He had two patients, one coming from East Coast, that West Coast, and another coming from Midwest of America. So two independent patients. He is a past life regression therapist. He does the past life. So now he says they are independent patients. They don't know each other. He found out, he traced their case histories appear to be very linked in the past life. So in one life, one person was a master and he is a goldsmith and he had a student. He has an employee whom he used to torture. He used to tie the employee to chain the employee and force him to do work, hard work. And if it doesn't come work properly, he will use hot iron rods to braise him. So next life, what happened? The roles reversed. The husband, the employee became the master, master became the employee. Next life. Okay, this is an independent collection. And this independent collection is published as an article. So in next life, what happened? The employee became master. Now employee is taking revenge on the former master. He is now farmer. agricultural land. Instead of using a bulls for tilling the ground, he is using a servant for tilling the ground. The servant is the master, and he used to whip him. Like that, he recollects for six, he collected data for six lifetimes, and he has published it. So the past life is about that. Now there's something called future life. Future life information goes or not. So there are many, many scientific, especially in the heart clinics all over the world, what they observed is called near-death experience, NDE. The patients are clinically dead for a few minutes or half an hour. So when the brain is dead clinically, they're called clinically dead because brain is the function of consciousness. So many of them become alive and they tell they have gone to different places, they have met different people, okay? And they are able to recollect vividly, and many of their lives are changed drastically. So there is a Kannada magazine editor called Santosh Gulwadi, Santosh Kumar Gulwadi, I think, earlier. He has written an article. He had a heart attack and he died. And after that, when he recovered, he had a death experience and he saw many people after death. And after that, his life changed. So this is called near-death experience. Near-death experience, hundreds of near-death experiences, irrespective of culture, irrespective of religion. There are hundreds of near-death experiences recorded, especially in the heart clinics all over the world. So this is about a future life. So the matter gets transformed, the energy gets transferred. So this I call as a reincarnation. And Buddha, the enlightened being, Buddha has a very great respect all over the world. He speaks about his 500 past lives. It's called Jataka tales. And our scriptures are full of, many of the scriptures are full of the past life memories. So does that answer give you a fairly overview of what reincarnation is all about?
Yeah, it gives me an overview of what reincarnation is, but it's just not enough proof. Like these are just, it could be made up stories or it,
no. There's no exact proof. Okay, right? Let me answer the question. You're asking for a proof, okay?
Yeah.
Just mute it. See, let us take the science, okay? Science is always work in progress. Do you agree or not?
Yeah.
Why?
Everything cannot be understood.
It's always work in progress.
Yeah.
Science always starts with a hypothesis. Hypothesis means imagination. Okay. And then somebody will come with the experiment and try to prove it. Right. And after some time, like maybe 100 years or 50 years of that theory will work good because it's only hypothesis. Please understand, it's not a reality. We can only hypothesis about reality. We cannot understand reality. Right? So now, science always starts with a hypothesis, ends up with experimentation, and uses that. That's fair enough. That's a matter of science. So now, is consciousness in the domain of science? Yeah, answer. Unmute and answer.
Yeah, everything is in the domain of science, like science.
No, so consciousness is not in the domain of science.
Okay.
Why? Because the method of science is always objective in nature. Correct?
Yeah.
Means I have to be able to observe with the sense organs and the mind. That is objective. Okay. But what is subjective is beyond the domain of science because subjective cannot be verified by any experiments. You understand? So what is subjective is beyond the domain of science because it's not objective. The science domain is objective. That's all. Correct? Now let us do a scientific experiment. Take your hand like this. Okay. Now pinch. Okay. Do you feel the pain? Yes or no? Unmute.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, which science will tell you how the pain? They can measure some chemical in the body, but pain cannot be understood by science because it's subjective experience. the consciousness is not in the domain of science because it's a purely subjective in nature. Okay, so there is a subject and object. A pure subject is called consciousness. Now, when we speak of reincarnation, we are speaking about consciousness. By definition, it is beyond the scope of science, by definition of science. So the scientists themselves acknowledge this. The scientists say the consciousness is a hard problem of science. Means consciousness, problem of consciousness cannot be solved by science. So to say that conscious science will one day prove about reincarnation is a very far-fetched way. You can do some observation, like I did told psychiatric experiments, past life regression, all those things you can do. But they are all objective in nature. They cannot prove the subject. Forget about proving birth, rebirth. It cannot prove you that you have pain. Because if you pinch, somebody will have pain, somebody will not have pain. Right? There's no way science can understand it because it's not objective. Okay, now let me ask you the question. Consciousness is a different domain compared to science. Are you understanding?
Yeah.
So there's a method of the scientific, but there is a science and consciousness have some commonality. The commonality is you start with the hypothesis, people do experiment and try to prove it objectively, right? The consciousness also, the same methodology is applied. I have told you about hypothesis that reincarnation is there. But the proof, you cannot depend on science. Proof, you have to find out yourself because you are the proof. You have to do experiment and you have to get convinced about it, about yourself, because your conscious experience, nobody can replicate. So who is the proof?
I am the proof.
You are the proof. I'm the proof. Cannot prove it to anybody else also.
Okay.
You can give only hypothesis. This I did. Buddha said, I went through 500 lifetimes. This is my hypothesis. Now it's for you to prove if you are interested. So the science and spirituality are a common method. There's a hypothesis. There's a experimentation. There's a proof. Now in the science, the experimentation can be any scientist can do. In spirituality, experimentation can be done by every individual. I have to do my experiment. You have to do experiment if you are interested. The proof is you. Okay.
Okay.
So now I'll tell you what is beyond another. Consciousness is not in the domain of science as per today. There are a lot of theories, but they're all objective verification of consciousness. Not you put a probe to the brain, so some signals will come, but that's an object. It's not about consciousness. It's a secondary effect, not primary. Correct. So then, is matter in the domain of science?
Yeah,
That's also false. So there are science has two groups. One is one group says consciousness is the hard problem of science, matter is the domain of science. The other group of scientists is there. You listen to them. They say matter is a hard problem of science. Consciousness is obvious. I don't need a proof of consciousness because I know I am. So consciousness, you don't need a proof. For matter, you need a proof. Now, all the scientists like Pranav and all, they do great research. They say, they write a beautiful equation of atoms and all. Nobody has seen an atom. Nobody has seen a subatomic particle. Only mathematical equations. It's all hypothesis. And the more they do, the finally they will end up with energy. So at the quantum level, whatever you are saying, it all disappears. Then many scientists say, the matter is also a hard problem of science. Because there's no objectivity there now. Okay, in other words, if you take it, consciousness and matter, both are hard problems. We can observe some symptoms, but we cannot go to the reality. Reality only we can have a hypothesis. You understand? Do you agree or not, Pranav?
Yes, Guruji.
Matter is also hard problem of science. Consciousness is a hard problem of science. Okay. But only thing is we start thinking of science. Oh, science means everything's validated. No, everything science in science is always work in progress. But everything in spirituality is proven by yourself. You prove it to yourself. You are the proof. So which is more solid science? You tell me now.
Yeah, consciousness, it seems to be a solid, like,
more. It is you. Okay, now yeah, if I ask you, does atom exist? Okay, or subatomic particle exist? You have to see some equation. Oh, this equation of subatomic particle. You'll never see a subatomic particle in your life. And you have to trust great scientists. Okay, you have to believe in them. They are like gods. Okay, but about consciousness, nobody has to prove you. No equation has to give you. You only have to go. You have to put your effort. And once you are convinced, that's all, over. Okay, so now, why matter is also a hard problem and consciousness is a hard problem in science? Because there's nothing called matter actually. Matter is there only for scientists to pursue their career, to make money and make some good things in life. So all that is there is air conditioning, science, aircraft, it's because of scientific discovery. But reality you cannot find. What is reality? You'll never be able to find objectively. Reality only can be found subjectively. Innermost experience, that innermost experience is called self-realization. So the science and consciousness, they come very close together in what we call as quantum physics, some extent. I'm not saying fully. So what consciousness says, what quantum physics, any observation will change the behavior of the matter. There's an observer is there. Observer is consciousness. Now give the equation for observer, the quantum physics cannot give. They'll say it's a quantum vacuum. So the quantum vacuum, I call it consciousness, where the consciousness and the science, they have almost come together. Maybe may not be true. That's my understanding. Okay. So now what a quantum physics says, Vedanta also speaks the same language. The duality, non-duality, all language of Vedanta is also similar to language of consciousness or language of quantum physics. That's why many of the quantum physicists, Schrodinger, okay, they say, when I look at Vedanta, it appears as much like a quantum physics to me. So what we call as quantum physics has much more parallels in understanding consciousness. So now let me give you one more example. When was the quantum physics discovered? Who started quantum physics? Who is the father of quantum physics?
I don't know.
Let us ask Pranav, who is that?
There are many. There's Bohr, Heisenberg, Schrodinger.
Okay, but you don't know Buddha was the father of quantum physics. Okay, a few thousand years back, Buddha went into deeper and deeper journey into consciousness. He saw the matter is getting created as particles, appears and disappears. Okay, the matter and combines into bigger and bigger. Matter gets combined into a bigger and bigger, grosser form. And he was able to see that matter at the subtlest form. Matter generating as particles and disappearing. So the first earliest discovery was made by Buddha. Before that, there was a person called Kanada. I don't know if you have heard of Kanada. Kanada said entire universe is made up of atoms. So it's a few thousand years back, even before Dalton formulated the atomic theory. Okay, so now we don't credit these people. So, but when Buddha saw that quantum particles, there was a deep change within him. There's a fundamental change happened in him. He became so peaceful because he saw it himself. Quantum particles in his consciousness. So that changed his life. He understood that matter is just unreal. Matter is just appearance. He became very peaceful. He got enlightened and he started teaching this to many people. Many people all over the world got peaceful. So what is the effect of consciousness journey? You get a ultimate peace and you can share that peace. So scientists also discovered quantum physics, quantum matter, atoms and discovered. What they did, they broke the atom and energy got released. So they then create a nuclear bomb and destroy so many people. So what is the difference between discovery of consciousness and discovery of consciousness and discovery of scientist?
One gives peace, another causes destruction.
Okay, they created other things also. They created atomic medicine, lots of many things. But even the greatest scientist will not be peaceful. He may have a atom collider. What is that? Particle collider. He may say subatomic particles with a screen on the computer screen, but he will not be peaceful. For peacefulness, you have to do inner journey. Why? Because whatever you see, even in a computer screen, you can see atomic particles generating, colliding. Okay, you can create a molecule, you can create a beautiful animation of a, but all those things are still imagination. It's a hypothesis. Whereas what you do in consciousness is your real experience because it's you. So, did I answer first part of your question? So you asked for proof, right? So now I ask for a proof of anything in science. You'll never be able to give the proof of reality. You can only hypothesis about reality.
Yeah.
Understand? So now here, but the difference is in consciousness, you are the proof. Nobody has to give a proof. Everybody can give a hypothesis. Reincarnation is there, but ultimately you are the proof. So are we clear?
Yeah, so I should find the proof by myself.
But you can take the inputs. You can take the theory, hypothesis, understanding what research has been done by rishis, what research has been saints, that you can intake as input. But ultimately you are the proof. Are we clear? So let us go to your next question.
Next question is there a higher entity called God? Like, is there something called as God? And okay.
I'll answer the question. What is there a higher entity called God?
Yeah.
Okay. So is there something called intelligence?